Hello everyone, this is Inga. Welcome to Tell Us What You Made. This is the show where we each make a different dish with one common ingredient or theme, then get together, compare notes, and see if we can learn anything. So this episode, Alvin, Rie, and I have each made a different dish using chocolate.
Hello.
Hello.
Alvin, you are first, as usual. Tell us what you made.
I made a chocolate tart in the style of Jacques Genet.
Ooh, fancy.
Yum.
So he is a famous pastry chef, and I love his tarts. He's been on a lot of TV shows, Mind of a Chef, and he just has this childlike fascination with pastry, and I made one of his recipes. To make the tart, I'm starting by making the crust first, so adding all-purpose flour, some powdered sugar, and some almond meal. This is kind of like a usual short crust pastry, and a little bit of salt, because I like salt in my pastry crust. Pretty standard, an all-purpose dough. I add a lot of butter, because butter is what makes pastry taste good. So after giving that a nice whirl, it kind of looks like this coarse, sand-like thing. It doesn't seem like it's gonna come together. But then the liquid to bind it is an egg. Oh, that's a nice egg. Oh, that's so orange.
Nice crack.
Oh, wow. Thank you. Nice crack. Never heard. Never
no,
think,
my
don't
gosh.
Hear that from Rie. But thank you. I try my best. Anyways, yeah, you know, just shaping my dough into a nice little smooth dough ball, putting it in between some parchment, and then just getting it smooth. I'm not completely rolling it out, but it's important to get the pastry to be kind of smooth before it chills. Mm-hmm. I should have used the rolling pin. I decided to use my hand.
Yeah, I was going to say, lazy. Are you just rolling it with your hand, just squishing it out? Okay.
I was like hitting it, massaging it, coaxing it, and then I realized I just should have used a rolling pin and did it. So after that gets chilled, you can see me like kind of trying to roll it out. I don't think I chilled it long enough, so the edges started to crack. So I was like, you know what? I put it back in the fridge and put it back out. Yeah, I was like, oh, this doesn't look right. So the dough is out and it's a little smoother, still some cracking, but yeah, I'm not that great at pastry. I have a sort of like this stainless steel cake mold, this ring, big tall one, that I like to make tarts in. It helps give it that nice clean round shape. And I think this allows that easier movement to sort of put the dough in and also remove it afterwards. So I like using it this way.
Oh, wow.
And then, you know, just kind of shoving the dough in there and trying to get it all smooth. And this trick, I like to use a clear glass cup that's sort of straight and round. And I kind of use that to get around the edges. Very fun.
That's a big,
a nice
big
tart.
Thank you. And because the edges are kind of ugly, I use a little knife to kind of cut off and try to level off the pastry if I can, but it's, you know, it's fine. I'll fix that later. But yeah, this is kind of like the base tart shell it's smooth. Yeah, and using a fork to poke in little holes so that the air bubbles just don't come up. That kind of helps it stay flat. Mm-hmm. And after that, I'm doing a blind bake, so I weigh down some parchment with rice. Because I'm Asian, that's what I have lying around.
I was gonna say. Usually it's like beans, right? Yeah. Or like pie weights.
Yeah, but I feel like it's such a waste of rice, but okay.
Isn't it too light if you use rice?
I use a lot of rice. It's like rice I've reused as baking weights for a long time. So this rice can definitely, it's like dried up. It can't be cooked. I sacrificed it. I know my ancestors probably, you know, shaking their head at me, but it's okay. Yeah, so following up on disappointing my ancestors, this goes into an oven at like 350 for maybe a whole hour. I really like to get the pastry really crispy. I think that's something that Mr. Jacques Chenin also notes in his recipe, is that even after it's done blind baking, you need to put it back in the oven and slowly get it so that it's as brown and as dark as it can be.
Uh-huh. What are you doing?
So the edges are not smooth, and I use a grater, like a microplane, to sort of like grate off all of the rough edges, and it really gives it that smoother look that you might find in pastry shops. I noticed that all of his tarts use this technique to kind of level it off, so that way, even though you make mistakes in the assembly, you can get it smooth and just, I think it looks better.
Yeah, it's super cool.
This is where the chocolate comes in the recipe. This is 70% bittersweet dark chocolate. This recipe is supposed to showcase the quality of the chocolate. So if you have good chocolate, that's why he uses this recipe. It's very simple. After that, it's a lot of cream, heavy cream, that I heat up in the microwave until it's just really hot and bubbly, kind of boiling, but not burnt. I'm slowly pouring it into the chocolate. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm not like, you know, drizzling it everywhere because I don't want air bubbles. That is the number one secret to this recipe, is to not have air bubbles. So it's kind of like when you pour beer on a side of a glass and you don't want it to like splash everywhere, is that you want to have the cream mixed in with the chocolate, but you don't want those air bubbles.
Did you put the bowl to kind of like keep the heat?
Yes. So the chocolate is room temperature, the cream is hot, and after the hot cream touches the chocolate, instead of stirring it right away, in the recipe, I believe he lets it sit so that it can slowly melt the chocolate and that the heat isn't too aggressive. And this next part is insanely crucial. So he says that when you mix it, the spatula goes down, touches the bottom of the mixing bowl, and you have to stir it and never ever lift the spatula from the bowl, or else you're gonna incorporate air. So I'm stirring this for like 10 minutes. I'm not even kidding. It's just the slowest motions possible, and it can be really discouraging because it doesn't look like anything's happening and you want to stir faster. But after 10 minutes, it looks smooth, and then you're finally validated.
I mean, isn't this the same thing as like making like ganache or like, you know, truffle?
Yeah,
it's, yeah, it's basically a ganache. It is a ganache. I think the ratio is 1-1, but yes. Yeah, my arm started to get really tired because you can't move it. You can't lift it from the bottom. It's like this slow, monotonous, painful stirring almost. But then the result is hopefully
the chocolate, the bowl of chocolate. That's what it is.
Ganache.
Yes. I just want to drink it.
Oh yeah, I lick the bowl and the spatula afterwards. And then kind of like shake it. So this goes in the fridge. After it comes out, it sets completely. It takes a couple of hours. This is it.
Wow.
Yeah,
is it the pastry knife?
I think so. It's the longest knife I had.
It's huge.
I'm struggling.
It looks like thick. A cake knife.
I added some Maldon sea salt on top because I love that. The texture is very fudge truffle-like, like you said. It's basically making truffles, but it's one big truffle.
It's like a velvety texture, right? Melts in your mouth.
Yes. I've made this recipe before, and having two different kinds of chocolate, you end up with two completely different tarts, which I think is a testament to Mr. Jacques Janine and his recipe.
The feeling it's only two ingredients, right? It's chocolate and heavy cream.
I've made this. I cheated the crust when I didn't have time. I just used store-bought pie crust and doubled it up and baked it. So you could technically make this with three ingredients if you wanted to.
I feel like coffee would be really good in this.
Inga, you are next.
So after dessert, I guess, I made curry.
Curry
finished off with chocolate. And I feel like, Rhea, you're going to be pretty familiar with this. I mean, I think adding chocolate to curry is something that I actually learned.
Secret ingredients, right?
Yeah.
I never tried it. But it kind of gives a depth, I think.
Yeah.
And also, I want to say, like, you like making sweet ingredients into savory and savory ingredients to dessert. It's very interesting.
Yes. I really love sweet and savory. It's like my favorite flavor profile. All right, to start it off, so basically my curry recipe is just, I make curry a lot at home. I did it a lot in college, even before college. And then my curry recipe is super straightforward. I always just put like potatoes, give it like a little water bath to help get rid of the excess starch because otherwise the curry might be too thick. Then I like chopping up my carrots like this. I don't know what you call it. Feels fun. I have no other reason beyond that. Yeah, so I'm basically just putting like a bunch of vegetables in it. It really also just depends on what's in my fridge. Oh, my meat. I think this one was beef chuck stew meat. It was on sale. That's why I bought it. And then I just do this little thing of cooking it up in my pot there. I just like searing the sides of the beef a little bit first to firm it up. And then with that remaining beef fat in the pot, don't want to go to waste. So I use the same pot to fry up the vegetables. Oh, and then I didn't do it here, but like actually one of the things I really like doing for this curry is like when I fry up the onion, I like to caramelize the onion prior to adding the rest of this stuff because it just is good. yeah. Once it has like a little bit of color, I just add in garlic and ginger.
Oh, ginger.
I think like ginger and garlic just go hand in hand really well. Carrots. And then I deglazed it with a little bit of sake. I'm learning from you, Rie. I'm just adding alcohol into everything.
It's nice, right? Like it's kind of gives nice flavor.
I love it. I really do that now all the time.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh yes.
This is not alcohol. Yes. I am adding water here, friends, not alcohol.
Okay. So I was like,
Oh no.
Ooh, and I then, like this.
Oh, and then this is dashi, right? This is my chosen broth, I think, for basically most of the dishes I make. Instead of like beef broth or vegetable broth, I love using this. It's just like sprinkling a little bit, and it just adds so much flavor. Wait, for those who don't know it, actually, Rhee, I feel like you might be better at explaining dashi stock.
Yeah, dashi is basically made with like dried fish or dried mushroom. And when you make miso soup or like some sort of stock, you use dashi. I think it's almost like a primer when you're painting. It doesn't, yeah, so it's kind of underlying.
Write that down.
I love that.
Like, you can just paint the paint, but if you put primer, it makes smooth. So it's kind of like underlining main ingredients, like highlighting main ingredient. And this dashi powder, it's instant, so you don't need to make from scratch. It's very popular among Japanese household.
So next thing I like adding is actually apples. I do this for, I think, also like when I make beef noodle soup, kind of like what we were saying earlier about how I just love adding sweet stuff to savory things. And I really like sugar. And after apples, I added in my potatoes, great. And I just let it cook. Oh, I also just like skimmed off the scum on top and just let it cook down. And then meanwhile, this is the classic Japanese curry roux blocks. I like to buy the hot version. It's not really that spicy. I use the entire curry package here, actually. Look at it. It's so beautiful. I love it.
Looks
it smells
like
so good.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? And I like to chop it up like this because I know some people just like throw the block in. But if you throw the block in, sometimes I think it gets stuck to the bottom or like it doesn't like, you know, melt as evenly. I think with this type of curry, you can really just like add whatever seasoning you want towards the end. I mean, pretty much once everything's soft, I added in my curry. I also added in honey, as if it wasn't sweet enough already. And then I added soy sauce and ketchup. So you can see I just like go a little crazy. This is all the, it's a, what I make with all ingredients. This is the...
Everything but the kitchen sink curry.
So yeah, I just like to give it a little taste, and depending on, you know, if I'm like, oh, I don't feel like it's sweet enough, I'll add more sugar or, you know. And then this is the chocolate I used. I used 100%. So it's not even bittersweet, it's just straight up like bitter chocolate.
Yeah.
You can totally use like, I think, sweeter chocolate, but I just wanted that one for like color, and also I wanted that sort of bitterness. You're actually not supposed to add this much chocolate. I went a little crazy because I was like, this is a chocolate episode, I can't just add like a tiny bit of chocolate. So I added the entire bar.
Whoa!
You see, right? You saw how the color change was like instant. I know some places actually like to add even more chocolate because they like that like super dark color. But yeah, I just serve it up with rice.
Yum.
It's
yummy.
The same color as the bowl.
Well, this is actually something nice. I eat a lot at home.
Yeah, I like how you make it's like, if you buy curry block, you there is an instruction how to make it. Uh-huh. Like, yours is not at all. Like, it's very different. Like, you kind of add your way. Because usually you don't glaze with sake, you don't add apple or chocolate. So,
yeah, I
think I like how you find your voice in a curry.
Thank you, Rhee. I found my voice in curry. I love that.
That's Rie's nice way of saying you're a rule breaker.
Hey, look, here's the thing. If you're gonna cook for yourself, cook it the way you wanna eat it, okay? Well, that was my curry. Rie, it's your turn. Take it away.
Yes. I made hot chocolate.
Oh, wait, I wanna see how you make hot chocolate, though. I feel like there's so many ways to do it.
Yeah, so there it's my hot chocolate 2.0. I used to 2. make
2.0.
I used to make ganache to make hot chocolate, but it was a little bit too rich. I like dark chocolate for anything, like hot chocolate. If I'm making cookie, I like, you know, dark, bitter chocolate. So I use chocolate bar. I'm making hot chocolate for one. So I'd use half bar, and it's like 6 little squares, and chop it so it melts quickly.
I love the way it curls off of your knife.
Yeah. And I'm measuring the cup I use. Just pour milk as much as I want to drink. Add chocolate, turn the heat.
Oh my God, is that the tiny whisk you're talking about from the other episode? You use the beater?
Wait, where's the rest of it?
Previously, we were talking about tiny utensils, and I don't have a tiny whisk, but instead I use electric mixers attachment, because it's semi-tiny, and it's smaller than whisk. It's very useful. I use it a lot.
Yeah.
First, I melt the chocolate, and then I add cocoa powder. I think I added 1 tablespoon.
What kind of cocoa powder is that? Is it Dutch processed?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a Dutch process. It's dark cocoa powder, melted, incorporated. Mm-hmm. And that's it. I also didn't add any sugar. I don't like too sweet. Also, I drink this in the morning, and it's like a breakfast.
Ooh, what was that?
That was a soft peak whipped cream.
Ooh. Okay.
Ooh. It's really good in a cold winter weather, but if you like something cold, you can just pour over ice, so you can drink ice hot chocolate. When I was little, my favorite hot chocolate is just a cocoa powder. I feel like adding chocolate kind of gives nice sweetness and a little bit more richer than just cocoa powder. So I kind of in the middle, cocoa powder and chocolate. Yeah, so that's my hot chocolate.
All right, so this has been our chocolate episode with Alvin's chocolate tart, my curry, and Rie's hot chocolate. So many fun ways to cook with chocolate. Also, let us know the different ways you use chocolate in the comments below. We'd love to check it out and, hopefully try it out in the future. Remember to subscribe if you want to see a lot more episodes of this Tell Us What You Made, because there will only be more to come and it'll be more fun. All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Does everybody have a chocolate stash that they save for eating?
I have a huge stash. Can we pull out our stash? Is this too much?
Let's pull out our stash.
Whoa!
Oh my God! What in the world? That's like a marker box.
It's
my God.